Morning.
Morning.
Morning. Thank you. Welcome. Welcome to South Bay's Inn. Welcome to 2023. And if you're like me, you already failed your New Year's resolution. So there's always next year. So keep that in mind. Good thing that, you know, I change a lot, but good thing God does not change and He's changeless. Let me read Psalms 102 for you. In the beginning, you, the Lord, laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you, God, remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like clothing, you will change them, and they will be discarded. But you, Lord, remain the same, and your years will never end. Amen to that. Well, I do have a few announcements. Some are in your bulletin, as always. I won't read them all, but I'll point out the ones I like. First one is men's Bible study. That's here this Saturday at 8 o'clock. Donuts are always provided. Coffee is always provided, and fellowship is always great. So if you are not busy Saturday morning, please join us at 8 o'clock here at the church. Also, women, there's an insert for Saturday morning fellowship. You can just read that on your time. just kidding. I want to welcome those who are online. Thank you. I'll keep my day job. So, as always, we have a fellowship and coffee downstairs. You are all expected to come down and join us for that. So please do that. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for this wonderful, wonderful day we have, Lord Jesus. Lord, I thank you for those that can make it, and I pray for those that are just not feeling well, Lord Jesus, and couldn't be here. But Lord, we can still fellowship. We can fellowship from miles apart through the internet or whatever, Lord Jesus. Lord, let's lift up this time and clear our minds of all those things that really don't matter in your eyes, Lord Jesus, that we can just focus on you. Lift up this time to you, Lord Jesus. Jesus'
name. Would you please take your common worship insert and follow along as I read the call to worship? If you could please read in the bold print. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth. Praise the Lord, from Psalms 113. Let's stand together now as we worship the Lord in song, giving him thanks and praise. Lord, thank you for this time to be still before you and acknowledge our need of you. Lord, we confess our sins to you and we praise you and thank you, God, for your unending, unfailing love towards us. In Jesus' name, amen. We hear the good news. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us, from Psalms 103. Would you please stand with us as we confess our faith together? We join together the oldest and most basic confession of Christian faith, words repeated over 2,000 years, words said in many different languages. Three words that bring us into relationship with God. Three words that set us apart and set the direction of our lives. Let us say them together. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus, the one and only Savior. Christ, God's anointed King. Lord, the ruler of our lives and the one before whom every knee shall bow. Let us say them again as we would shout to the world,
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Our only
be seated.
Christ, I hope in life and death, what a tremendous thing to be able to share and to celebrate together. It's so good to see you. Glad that we are able to be together. There's nothing like coming together and worshiping together and being in the same room, lifting our voices and responding to God's word and declaring our faith as we have had opportunity to do. I want to draw your attention to the white insert, which says our text for 2023. So for the last two or three years, we've singled out a specific verse or text, and we've said this is going to be a focus for us throughout the year. And, you know, it's a challenge to do this, and I always pray about it, and the Lord just absolutely directed me to this very familiar text, but one that I want to challenge us to memorize. It's two verses. I'm going to challenge us to memorize them. And as I say on this sheet, this is a life-directing text. This is the direction that we are called to take in our lives after we've come to faith in Jesus Christ, received Him as Lord and Savior, and we know who we are in Christ. This is our response. And this is not a one-time thing. This is an ongoing, daily response. So I want to encourage us to memorize them. They flow together actually very, very well. Encourage us to memorize them. I'm going to encourage us to meditate on them, take time, and meditate on what you're hearing Paul saying. And then from time to time, I will bring us back to this text and maybe take just a little time before a sermon and just pose some questions to direct us back into this text. Maybe take just a couple of minutes just to pose some questions about it. And I've actually made some little notes on my calendar to remind myself to do that. But if you have that sheet in front of you, I'd like for us to recite it together as we begin to memorize it. Again, it begins with therefore, which always says go back and see what it's there for. So this is building on what Paul has said in the first nine chapters of Romans, which is all about what God has done for us in Christ. What God has done for us in Christ, then you turn this corner, and everything from chapter 12 on to the end of Romans is then this is how you live. Based on what you believe, chapters 1 through 9, then this is how you live. So let's say it together. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. We're going to look to the Lord in prayer, but before we do that, again, I want to draw your attention to some prayer, ongoing prayer needs that are listed on the back of your bulletin. And I just want to express to you, Leah and Ron, our heartfelt sympathy and our love to you in the passing, the death of your mother, Arlene, this past week. A wonderful, wonderful lady who I was privileged to know over the years, starting way back there when she was working at Grandview, and then just over the years, always just a delightful person who has left a legacy of faith, a legacy of trust, an example for all of us. And please be in prayer for Leah and Ron, her sister Wendy, all their children. There is a memorial service tomorrow at 11 a.m. for Arlene at New Hope in Cambridge, and there's a visitation starting an hour before that service. And then I also want to just say that either Friday or yesterday, a container arrived in Uman, Ukraine, which is about 90 miles from Smila, where our sister church is. All these containers, which are sent locally from hand-to-hand logistics, all of the materials that are on those containers are all donated. Everything is donated and then shipped by hand-to-hand logistics. That container specifically, well, has a lot on it, but for our sister church and two other churches that we relate to in Smila, there are three pallets of clothing, which will include coats and jackets and all other manner of clothing for the refugees that the churches in Smila are helping. There is also a pallet, and I don't know how many boxes that is, of a dried rice mixture. It's kind of a ready-to-eat meal. People just add boiling water to it. That will be going to Smila and will be divided among those three churches. Very, very grateful for this. Very, very thankful to God that He's raised up this ministry of hand-to-hand logistics. And I encourage you to pray for it and prayerfully consider how you might be involved in help in the support of this. The cost is the containers. That's it. There's no other cost except the shipping of these containers. And the need is so enormous. I don't know if you saw the news yesterday, if you read news online, or you saw it on evening news about the across Ukraine yesterday, there were massive Russian missile strikes. One of those hit a city, which is the third largest city in Ukraine, Dnipro. It took down what is a huge 12-story apartment building. Russia is a terrorist state. Russia aims these attacks not at just military targets. In fact, most of their attacks from the air are directed to hitting civilian targets. So what does that mean if a large 12-story apartment building is brought down? Well, it means there's more refugees internally displaced within Ukraine. The churches in Ukraine will be attempting to house and help, including in Smila. So great, great prayer. And then to kind of put that in perspective, I think sometimes as Americans, this is such a distant thing, it's hard for us to think about. Those of us who've been to Ukraine, been to Smila, we can visualize life there. We can visualize the cities. So this massive attack, Russian missile attack, missiles fired from hundreds of miles away, the targeted civilian structure in Dnipro. Put that in perspective. The distance from where our sister church is to Dnipro is about the same as the distance from here to Des Moines. That's about the distance. So think about that. Think about what that is like for people who, yes, they're living in relative safety right now in Smila and in that region. This horrendous missile strike, which has now killed scores and made hundreds more homeless, is about as far away as Des Moines is from us. So urgent need, and that's why we're partnering. That's why we're giving in our own Ukraine Emergency Relief Fund. That's why we're partnering with hand-in-hand logistics. May we pray. Christ, our hope in life and death. Lord, I'm so grateful that we can sing that truth. You, Lord Jesus, are our hope today. You are our hope for the rest of our lives. You are our hope for eternity. There is nothing more important than knowing and following you, Lord Jesus. You are the reason for which we have been created. You are the source of our life, and we praise you. We also thank you that we have the privilege to come before the throne of grace and to ask and to intercede as your word tells us to do. And we come, Lord, in intercession for brothers and sisters in Christ, some within our church family who are experiencing illness, some who are experiencing difficulties in health, some who are experiencing grief. And Lord, I just want to pray right now for your comfort and your encouragement, continued encouragement to the family of our beloved sister Doris Fell, as they and we mourn her passing. And I also want to pray, Father, for the peace of God and the comfort of the Holy Spirit to be upon Leah and Wendy and Ron and all of their family as they grieve the passing of Arlene Walberg. We thank you for her life, her testimony that lingers, and we thank you that she is at home. Her passing is our loss, but her gain. And so we pray for your help and encouragement to all those who grieve. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine and the trial of fire that they are going through. And we thank you and we praise you that you have given us, you have gifted us here in this country, and for us in our church and in other churches with an ability to help in a small way, but a way that is making a difference in the lives of individuals and families. Thank you for that. We pray for continued protection, for continued care and peace and encouragement to our brothers and sisters there in Sweden. Now, Lord, we come to your word. We come because we need to hear a word from you. We need your word in our lives. And as always, our prayer is give us ears to hear, minds that will be open, hearts that will be receptive, and move our wills in obedience to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to turn in your Bible to Philippians chapter 2. We began last week this series entitled Marriage Management. And on one side of that yellow insert that you have in your bulletin, you have the schedule or the direction we're going to be taking. We started last week, and this is where we're going to be going. And just a brief comment on this wonderful letter. It's a very short letter, just four chapters. The letter to the Philippians is a delightful letter to read. It's a delightful place to come to. Paul had started the Philippian church several years before on a missionary journey. He had come there on the second missionary journey. And this is not a letter of correction. This is not a letter like 1 Corinthians or the letter to the Galatians that was written to correct serious problems within the church. It would seem that this is a very healthy church. And this is a letter that is essentially an extended thank you. The Philippians, who are actually very poor, they live in a very relatively poor region, yet they were extremely generous, and in their generosity, they helped the apostle. They supported him, and he's thanking them. But he's also not just thanking them in this letter, but he's writing to encourage them. He's writing to encourage them. He's writing to give them some direction as disciples. Again, not particularly dealing with specific problems, but just to say, you know, here's some things that you need to know, and I want to impress upon you. Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to their own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place, and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. For for planes to fly, for cars to run, for houses to stand, and marriages to succeed, there must be good maintenance. I found this definition of maintenance: the process of maintaining or preserving someone or something as so as to continue its health, usefulness, or success. Without maintenance, planes don't fly. I came across this, I thought, fascinating bit of information. This is from I found a website called Ask the Pilot. And one of the questions that was on there about Ask the Pilot is, how many miles, how long can a commercial airliner fly? And it gave many examples, but one of them is that of a Boeing 777. A Boeing 777 is a big plane. Big plane, carries over 300 people on it, used in long-haul flights. And it said a Boeing 77, Boeing 777, 37s, is expected to have a 30-year lifetime, a 30-year lifetime of useful service. And what will that mean if it has and it's a long-haul plane, what will it mean if it has an average of a 30-year lifetime of service? It means that it will fly about 52,500,000 miles. 52,500,000 miles. I don't know about you, but I'm not looking for that on my car. That's amazing. I mean, that is, you think about that. That is really astounding. And you ask the question, well, how is that possible? And that's not unique to that aircraft. Maintenance. Plan, maintenance that will take place again and again and again and again at regular intervals. Without maintenance, they don't fly. Without maintenance, marriage doesn't fly either. Which sometimes I think for us is kind of an eye-opener when we come into marriage, at least. I'm just going to say for me, I don't think I was conscious of this 50 plus years ago now, but without maintenance, marriage doesn't fly either. The goal of maintenance isn't to fix it after it breaks, but to head off the breakdowns. Not just to fix it after it breaks, but to head off the breakdowns. And that's really the goal of this series. As we focus on maintenance marriage, what are some things that you and I, if we're married, we have to be aware of, and there's some areas we need to maintain and give some attention to, not because there's been a breakdown, but to prevent that. Now, what we've seen and where we're at and where we're going. Last Sunday, we were in Genesis 2 and 3. Genesis 2 is referred to as the text of first reference. When it comes to marriage, it's the text where we first see God's design and God's plan for marriage. So I want to bring us back there just very briefly once again to a quick review of God's plan and God's design for marriage. Genesis 2, in verse 24, we said last week in this text of primary reference, this is the foundation upon which marriage is built. And this is really God, the designer of marriage's purpose statement for it. Verse 24, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Here is God's wonderful design. I'm not going to preach that sermon over again, but I'm going to say inherent in this wonderful design are four key words: priority, permanence, unity, and intimacy. Priority. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother. Not saying that you forsake them, not saying that you're not close to them, but simply saying, but now, this union of husband and wife, this is the priority relationship. And this is the priority relationship, not just in terms of parents, but to all other relationships. This, there is priority. There is permanence. They are to be united, and that word united is actually a very strong word. It means to be bonded. It's describing something that is not designed to be broken apart. There is permanence, and there is a wonderful unity, and to be united to his wife, and then there is intimacy, and they were both naked, and they felt no shame. And here's the thing, folks, the design of the Creator given there in Genesis 2:24, the design hasn't changed. It's exactly the same today. This is what marriage is. But as we saw from Genesis 3, it is now a design lived out in a broken world. Sin entered the world. Sin entered the picture in Genesis 3, as we saw in the rebellion of Adam and Eve, and their disregard of God and God's commandments, and their thinking that they can be in charge of their own lives. And sin entered the picture, and we begin to see this immediately in Genesis 3. Sin distorts all relationships. Sin distorts all relationships. Our relationship with God. Now there's a relationship of running and hiding from God. And now there's a barrier between God and man. It distorts relationships with others, our fellow human beings. And it definitely, folks, it definitely distorts our relationship in marriage. Today we are going to continue to look at the fundamental problem that robs marriage of joy, and it causes and can cause its breakdown. And we will see the remedy for this, the rescue that we have in Christ. And then after today, we're going to be looking at some specific areas of maintenance. So in our text, back in Philippians chapter 2, Paul is not specifically addressing husbands and wives. Paul is writing about the life of the church. So, how does this speak to marriage? In the church and in marriage, there is a common goal and there is a common enemy. In both the church and in marriage, there is a common goal and there is a common enemy. The goal of marriage is oneness, the sharing of life, the building into the other, the sharing of life or unity. That's clear from Genesis 2 and what we just read. Now let's consider the maintenance of what I'm calling our other-centeredness. That marriage is to have to it an other-centeredness rather than a self-centeredness. Let's consider the maintenance of other-centeredness. Well, first of all, just very briefly, what that does not mean. To maintain our other-centeredness in marriage does not mean not taking care of myself. It doesn't mean not taking care of myself. In fact, one of the best things that you can do for your spouse is, in fact, take care of yourself. It doesn't mean not taking care of myself. It does not mean not expressing my wants, my needs, my dreams, etc. It doesn't mean that. Other-centeredness is what Paul is describing in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 2. This is what other-centeredness looks like. He says, make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Other-centeredness in a marriage is by being like-minded. What does that mean? Does that mean uniformity of opinion? That we must share exactly the same opinions. We must never differ. Does that mean we cannot have individual likes and dislikes? No, that's not what it means, either in marriage or in the church. But being like-minded how? About our commitment to each other. About being like-minded that our relationship is the most important thing under God that we have. being like-minded in our desire to serve the other, being like-minded in our desire to come and set goals. Come and set goals for our life. Come and set goals for our marriage. So he says to the church, and I think it applies to marriage, this oneness or unity involves being like-minded, having the same love, having a mutual love, a mutual, and we're going to talk more in a sermon specifically about love, but love is much more than an emotion. Love is an ongoing commitment to the welfare of the other, having that same love where each person knows, I know the other is absolutely committed to my good. I know the other would sacrifice himself or herself for me. Having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. Again, not uniformity. One in spirit and purpose. That we understand that we are better together. And I think as Christians, I would challenge us as Christian couples to ask the question, what is God's purpose in our marriage? And you can't say this to a non-Christian couple. How can we as a couple in our marriage uniquely glorify God? How can we as a couple glorify God? How can we as a couple in our relationship bear witness to Jesus? So what does this oneness in marriage and unity look like? Being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. And it means each saying to the other, I want to serve you. I want to serve you. And we'll see more about that later. So the goal of marriage, as it is for the church, is oneness and unity. And the great enemy of marriage is our selfishness. The great enemy of marriage is our selfishness. And one of the things I appreciate about God's word, about the Bible, is its brutal honesty about people. And its brutal honesty about the people of God, the people whom God has chosen, the people that God uses. And so you go, and no surprise, right, if we know what human nature is, that when we go through the Bible, we see a lot of examples of selfish behavior, and some of them among God's people. I mean, I think about Abraham. Abraham, who is the example of faith. He's held up in Hebrews chapter 11 as, you know, the example of faith and trust in God, which he is. The man God entered into covenant with. But Abraham acted in some very selfish ways. I mean, you go into Genesis 12, and God has just entered into this covenant relationship with Abraham, in which he's promised him, I will make your name great, I will make you into a great nation, I will bless you, and all the families of the earth will be blessed. And then later in that same chapter, we have him in a faithless moment thinking, well, God can't take care of me, there's now a famine in the land where he lives, and I need to go to Egypt. And then to make matters worse, he says to his wife Sarah, look, this is how it's going to go. When we head down there to Egypt, they're going to look at you and they're going to say, she's a very beautiful woman. And so they're going to think, well, let's just kill the husband and we can have her. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to go down to Egypt, and you're going to say you're my sister. I mean, talk about throwing your wife under the bus. You say you're my sister. I'm looking out for number one. You may be put into a harem, but I'm looking out for number one here. Not his best moment. What is that? Selfishness. One of the key people in biblical history. You go down, fast forward hundreds of years, you come to David. David, the man after God's own heart. David, the man to whom God said, through your family, through your descendants, I will build a kingdom that will never end. Direct line from Jesus, from David to Jesus. And what do we know about David? What do we know about Bathsheba? And we know about his desire to have Bathsheba. And we know about his adultery. And then we know about his unwillingness to come clean about that adultery and to cover it up, even to the extent of committing murder. Selfishness. David has in his life a big black spot of selfishness. Okay, fast forward into the New Testament, an incident with two of Jesus' disciples, two of the apostles, James and John, come to him one day. And these are great followers. These are going to be great, you know, pillars of the church. But at one point, James and John, the two brothers, come to Jesus and say, look, when you come into your kingdom, we want thrones on either side of you. You know? I mean, forget about all the others, right? We want to be right up there. What is that? That's selfishness. Well, the great enemy, again, not unique, okay? You find it in the lives of the people of God all through the Bible. But here it is. Notice how Paul talks about it with the Philippian believers in verse 3. So verse 2, this is what makes unity and oneness possible. This is the enemy of unity and oneness that he has to point out to them. Verse 3, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. There it is. Selfish ambition. I am just thinking about me and what I want and where I want to go. And I don't care about you and I don't care what I have to do, because actually, in our relationship, you're there to help me achieve what I want. That's selfish ambition. Vain conceit. What does that mean? Vain conceit. Oh, arrogance? Narcissism? I think more of myself. You know, you don't measure up to me. I think more of myself than I do of you. There is no place for that. That is the great enemy. That is the heart of selfishness. And those things, those things that Paul describes here in talking to the Philippians over in Galatians chapter 5, he lists those as what he calls the works of the flesh, the works of the sin nature. This comes out of the inherent bent that we have in us. This, folks, the bent towards selfishness is inherent in our sin nature. So he's saying to them, don't be driven by those desires. Don't be driven in that direction. We all have this bent. We do not all have it to the same degree, but we all have it. And it's like this. When we get married, there is this uninvited guest. There is this uninvited guest who may show up at any time. And that uninvited guest is selfishness. Selfishness. What does selfishness in marriage look like? It can have myriad appearances. Let me give you five things. What selfishness in marriage may look like. It may look like rigid thinking. I have my idea. This is what I think. Don't challenge me. Don't suggest anything else. It's just a rigidity in thinking. It's my way or the highway. It may look like in our marriage never taking responsibility for mistakes. Never taking responsibility. Never able to say, I was wrong. Never being able to offer an apology. Thirdly, selfishness in marriage looks like a lack of respect for your mate's individuality. A lack of respect for your mate's individuality. For the fact that this man, this woman, is uniquely made in the image of God and is not like you. And it has a unique individual, unique personality, unique gifting. And selfishness shows a lack of respect for your mate's individuality. Number four is a symptom of selfishness in marriage is being a control freak. You have to be in control of everything that, that happens. And number five is insisting on you both do what you want. Insisting that you both do what you want. So the goal of marriage is oneness or unity. The great enemy of marriage is selfishness. And on our own, we do not do a very good job. Let me put it like this. We do not do a very good job on our own naturally from turning away from this. Some may to some extent, but we tend not to do a very good job. We may resolve to do better. And ironically, often our attempts, and this is the root of selfishness, often our attempts at doing better in this area often end up reinforcing the problem. Our attempts to do better in this often reinforce the problem, and it comes out in a statement like this, where you say to the other, you say to your spouse, hey, give me some credit, I'm trying. Give me some credit, I'm trying. But what are you doing? You're just reinforcing your selfishness. But we're not left to ourselves. Again, this is the difference, folks, in the Christian's marriage, the marriage of people who are committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're not left just to ourselves. The great resource for the Christian marriage is the life of Jesus and the power of the cross. The great resource for Christian marriage is the life of Jesus and the power of the cross. So go back to verse 1, how Paul begins this. He begins it in an interesting way. He says, if you have, and this is not being said as if to raise a question, do you think you have this or not? If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if you have any comfort from his love, if you have any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion. Now, he's not saying when he says if there, he's saying that to get them to think about it. In other words, this is a rhetorical device to stimulate them to consider it. If you have this, you could turn this around. And actually what he's saying to them is, since you have this, you have encouragement. You are encouraged because you're united with Christ. You have comfort from his love. You have fellowship with the Spirit. You have experienced tenderness and compassion from him in your life, in your experience. What do we have? Well, the key to it is the statement in verse 1. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, what you have, folks, husband, wife, Christian, husband, wife, what you have is the privilege of knowing you are united with Jesus Christ. You share, you are a partaker in the life of Jesus Christ. The life of Christ is in us. What does that mean? Well, it means that we don't have to try harder just on our own to produce something. And we have been united to the very life of Christ. We have the resource of Christ in us. And we have the power of the cross. So after Paul has said, he's not dealing with a specific problem. He's pointing this out by way of encouragement. He says, he's saying, I know you're united with Christ. I know you have fellowship with the Spirit. I know you've experienced tenderness and compassion from God. Then notice that little connecting word, verse 2. Then, because you are in Christ, because you've experienced the life of Christ, then make my joy complete by what? Carrying out in your behavior these things that build oneness. But then you come down to verse 5. And there's something much more. He says your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Your attitude in your life as a Christian husband, your attitude as a Christian wife should be the same as the attitude that Jesus exhibited here in the flesh when he came to do what the Father had sent him to do. And this is what Christ did for you. He did not grasp his equality with God, which is to say, no, he did not give up his equality with the Father, but he didn't grasp it, which is to say, he didn't try to use it to his own advantage, but instead, he made himself nothing. The one who made the universe, the one who sustains it every second, he made himself nothing. He took the nature of a servant when he was made in human likeness. He came as a servant. The Lord became a servant all the way to the point of death. All the way to the point in his obedience as a servant to humble himself even to death on a cross. This is what Christ has done for you. And because this has happened, you see, child of God, Christian, because this has happened, you have been made radically right with God. You have been made radically right with God. Not because of your performance, not because how spiritual you are, not because of all of your efforts to do what's good. You have been made radically right with God solely on the basis of what Jesus Christ did for you on the cross when he died for you and then rose from the grave. So what does that mean? It means you don't have to listen to the voice of self-centeredness. The voice will still be there in your mind. Look out for number one. I have a right. You ought to. Okay? The voice will still be there. But what this means is you don't have to listen to that voice of self-centeredness. Why? Because you are a new creature. Because your life, as Paul would say to the Colossians, your life is hidden with God in Christ. Because you actually have the ability to talk back to yourself. You have the ability to recognize that uninvited guest, that selfishness. And you have the ability to say no, not in your own strength, but in the power of Christ. You have the ability to live differently. And you can. You can. He will give to you, because of the Holy Spirit within you, because of the power of the cross that has already made you right with God, he will give you the ability to say no to selfishness, which Jesus says is actually a requirement to be one of his disciples. He said, to be my disciple, you must deny yourself, which means say no to self-desire sometimes. Say no to what I want to do. And we don't naturally have that ability. But through the power of Christ in us and through the power of the cross, we do. And Paul will put it like this in Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. My life has been changed. I have been a partaker in what he achieved on the cross. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But the life I live now in this body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I have a new direction to my life. I do not have to be a servant to sin. I do not have to be a servant to my own selfishness. This will not be without pain. This will not be without pain. What I'm talking about is not an event in your life and mine. It is a process of dying daily. It is what Paul calls in Galatians 3:5, putting to death some things. This is not a one-time thing, but by the enablement of Christ's life in you and the power of the cross which has been released to you, you and I can enter into this difficult process, but process of daily dying, recognizing the ugliness of selfishness when it is there, and repenting, which means I'm going to say, I don't want that. Lord, I agree with you. This is wrong. This is wrong. I can't justify this selfishness. This is wrong. I'm going to agree with you. I want to ask your forgiveness. And Lord, I want to die to this in my life by your enabling power. This is a process of dying daily. I came across this statement. I think it's a wonderful statement. I don't even remember where I found this quote, but I really like it. Marriage is a lifelong process designed to teach you to see the needs of another person as more important than your own. Marriage is a lifelong process designed to teach you to see the needs of another as more important than your own, which is exactly what Paul said. And this is the great counter to selfishness when Paul says to them, in humility, consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interest. That's natural for us. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. Have the same attitude as Christ. Marriage, the goal of marriage is oneness or unity. The great enemy of marriage is selfishness. The great resource for the Christian marriage is the life of Jesus and the power of the cross. You see, if you're married, you are in a life, you have a lifelong need, a maintenance need, to maintain the other-centeredness. The other-centeredness of your marriage. It does not come naturally, but it comes supernaturally as you obey and follow the Lord and daily submit to Him, daily turn to Him, daily admit your failures, daily receive His cleansing, and daily depend on His power. May we bow together. Sometimes, Lord, your word is like the scalpel of a surgeon. Sometimes it cuts. Sometimes it cuts deeply. But if your word cuts us, it is like the surgeon's use of a scalpel, cutting us not for the purpose of wounding, but for the purpose of healing. Help us to be open to the cutting that you may be needing to do and wanting to do in our lives. The fight to overcome selfishness and to live with other-centeredness in our lives, and not just for married people, but for all of us, is not easy. But Lord, we have you, and you are sufficient. And your grace is sufficient. And your presence is with us. And you are for us. And you are for our marriages. And if the Holy Spirit uses the scalpel and it hurts, help us to cooperate with what He's doing. And to say, Lord, cut me in order to cure me. Wound me in order to make me whole. Help me to get over my self-centeredness and to live for the other. I pray in your precious name. Amen.
Let's stand together as we close. Speak, O Lord. Continue to have this word and this truth speak to us.
Your truth, let it be.
those of you who may be watching, we thank you for joining us today. May God bless you. Thank you for being here, all of you who are here together. We do invite you to join us downstairs for refreshments and fellowship together. And let me encourage you, when you go down, and if you should happen to go downstairs, and I know how we are, we make a beeline, we see somebody, oh, I can't wait to be with my friend again. But listen, if you go downstairs today or on any Sunday, and you look around and you see a person, you see a couple, and they're sitting by themselves, would you get up or move and share that table with them? We don't want anybody to feel left out. We don't want anybody to feel like they don't matter and they're not important. Now, I bring you this word of benediction from Jude, verse 24. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.